Okay, great. So, good evening and welcome to the Capa Solar Planning Commission meeting. We are meeting via Zoom because of the COVID, and there are several ways that the public can watch and participate. On the screen now, you should be able to see the several ways that you can join in the meeting: by phone, by the webinar, and we welcome your participation. If you are a Zoom attendee, raise your hand as a participant and then just wait to be recognized. So with that, we will call the regular meeting of the Capitola Planning Commission to order. May we have the roll, please, Edna? Oh, I'm sorry. Tonight, on the meetings can be viewed live on the city's website and also on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast 25 and AT&T UVerse Channel 90. And our technician tonight is Noel Cobby. Okay, roll call, please, Edna.
Here.
Commissioner Newman?
Here.
Commissioner Westman? Commissioner Westman? Commissioner Wilk?
Here.
And Chair Ruth?
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Edna. And now we'll start the meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance,
to the flag. The United States of America, and to the Republic, and to stand one nation, under God,
liberty,
and justice for all.
We're getting better. Okay, that brings us to item two on the agenda tonight, which is oral communications. Katie or Matt, are there any additions or deletions to the agenda?
There are no additions or deletions to the agenda this evening.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any people standing by to make public comments?
We do have a public comment for 307 McCormick, which was emailed in, which I can read to the record, into the record when that item comes up. And
okay.
Going back to the
looks like there is one hand raised right now.
Oh, is there? Okay.
Okay. These are for items that are not on the agenda.
So let's see.
I believe this is the person who has the comment for 307 McCormick, but.
Okay, well, we'll wait till we get to that particular item then. If they can hear us, we'll be there in probably just a few minutes. So we'll move on. Any commission comments tonight?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I have a comment.
Okay.
So I don't want to reopen debate on this topic, but for the record, I would like to voice my disapproval of adding the color board in the applications for these proceedings. That's my only comment.
Okay. As noted, I'm sure it will be in the minutes. Hey, any staff comments?
I'll have a director's report at the end of the meeting. No staff comments at this time.
Okay. Our next item in is the approval of the minutes from the regular meeting of March 4th, 2021. I understand there is a correction to the minutes. Commissioner Newman, did you have a correction?
I didn't catch it, but apparently the minutes reflect my approval of the color board initiative, which I do not approve of. So that should be changed.
So for Edna, that is item 4A. In the last paragraph, it's changing the name Ed Newman to Mick Ruth.
Okay, thank you, Matt, and thank you, Commissioner Newman. I will have noted the change, and I will update the minutes to reflect the change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, any other additions or corrections to the minutes? Hearing none, is there a motion to approve?
So moved. Commissioner Wilk.
Is there a second?
I'll second, Commissioner Christensen.
Motion to second to approve the minutes as modified. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Yes. Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman is absent. Commissioner Wilk?
Aye.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye. And the motion carries, the minutes are approved. Okay, that brings us to item four, the consent calendar. We have two items on the consent calendar tonight, 1447th Avenue for a second story addition, and 4850 Topaz for a remodel of an existing three-story family residence. Is there any one of these items any member of the commission would like to pull for discussion?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I'd like to pull item B, 4850 Topaz Street, just to get a question answered.
Okay. Well, let's take item A first, 1447th Avenue. Is there a motion to approve?
So approved. So moved.
Have a second?
Commissioner Wilk.
Procedurally, I think we need to make sure no member of the public would like to pull an item off prior to making a motion.
Okay, well, we do have the motion on the floor, so is there any member of the public who wishes to address 47th Avenue or Topaz Street?
In the Zoom meeting, none of the attendees are raising their hands, and it looks like there's no public comment within the public comment email,
okay, so
we're okay to proceed. We'll
continue. Is there a second then to the motion to approve 1447th Avenue?
I'll second.
We have the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second for Commissioner Christensen.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Oh, we need a roll call, please, Edna. I'm sorry.
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
I abstain due to proximity.
Okay. And Commissioner Westbrook is absent. Commissioner Wilk?
Approve.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, 1447th Avenue is approved, and let's go to 4850 Topaz. Mr. Wilkes, you had a question.
I did. When I looked at the conditions of approval, there was a requirement for an 8-foot fence, the last 2 feet being lattice, and I wanted to get an understanding of, was that in fact buying any privacy? And Sean, I believe, was maybe going to take a look at that and give me a response.
Hey, did you get your response?
No, I'm hoping I will get it right now.
Sean?
Yes, I'm here. Good evening, commissioners. To that question, I want to first state that it wasn't included as a condition of approval to have a changed fence. It was included as details in their color material board that they were proposing to modify their existing fence or replace it with a taller fence that included lattice so that it would be up to 8 feet, but it was not included in their conditions of approval. And it was by the recommendation of staff as a mitigation measure. I don't have a visual for you on the rear yard, but it looks like they have an approximately 6 to 7 foot fence there already. So that would be going up 1 to 2 feet from the existing fence height.
Okay. Well, that's an allowable fence under our rules.
Right. So my concern was that was a recommendation that came up during ARC and site, and they agreed to do it. But my concern is that did they feel perhaps undue pressure in order to try to get their whole building approved and willing to accept things that are unnecessary? So I called Matt and I said, well, I was concerned about that. If the idea is to add some privacy, by all means, but it's already a second story. I wasn't sure how adding another 2 feet would add any privacy. And was it just a frivolous condition or a frivolous request by Arkansas? And I thought I was going to get a better answer than So. I guess my concern would be I'd want to know if they in fact would prefer to leave the fence alone or just have a 6-foot fence, or perhaps if no one objects to that not being a condition, if staff, if everybody's okay with staff just contacting them and saying that that is not a requirement, and that the Planning Commission does not require it as part of the application, then it's up to them whether or not they want to be a good neighbor or not. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. Makes sense to me. It's be strictly voluntary on their part.
I believe...
Okay, is that, would that be okay if staff makes that communication to the applicant that we do approve the application and that we reviewed the fence requirement and determined it was not something we particularly insisted on?
So I believe we actually do have someone with their hand raised. I'm not sure if it's the owner. So
that is one of the owners.
Okay, so after discussion and questions, we can open the public hearing. And
okay, any other questions for staff regarding this project on Topaz Street? If not, then we'll open it up to the applicant. If the applicant's present, you can enter into the conversation now.
Okay.
Mr. Sokolov?
I'm going to go ahead and give him the ability to talk here. So all he has to do is unmute himself now.
Great. Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me okay? This is Ross.
Yes.
So first, I want to thank Commissioner Wilkes for his comments and consideration. That meant a lot. But the idea to go to a higher fence is twofold. One is we do want to make sure we're sensitive to neighbors, and we wanted a higher fence. The second reason is because I'm 6'7", I don't want them seeing me either. So it really is something that we choose to do, not feel like we have to.
Thank you. Then I move approval of this application.
Thank you, Mr. Sokolov. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Here we have a motion and a second to approve the application at 4850 Topaz Street. And then we have the roll call, please.
Yes, Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
He's muted.
Sorry. Hi.
Commissioner Westman is absent. Commissioner Will?
Aye.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye. The motion carries. Good luck, Mr. Sokolov, with your project. That brings us to item 5, public hearings. We have one tonight at 307 McCormick Avenue. This is a design permit for a first and second story addition and a variance request for the parking space dimensions and side yard setbacks. Matt, you're doing the presentation?
Actually, Sean.
Sean.
Good evening, commissioners. So the application before you is 307 McCormick Avenue. It's a proposal to add 703 square feet in addition to the first story and a new second story to an existing 1,148 square foot, one-story single-family residence. The existing residence is, as I mentioned, a one-story single-family home. It's non-conforming due to proximity to the side setback. It's located above Depot Hill, and it's in between Depot Hill and Noble Gulch Park, surrounded by one- and two-story single-family homes. This is the proposed site plan. Orange indicates the enclosed first and second story additions, including the garage to the front. The second story deck is shown in green behind. These are the existing and proposed single story floor plans. And this is the new second story with the deck. These are the existing and proposed front elevations. And here's the rear. These are the existing and proposed north elevations on the east side to the right. And these are the elevations existing and proposed to the left. The applicant has requested a variance to the required covered parking space dimensions and the required side yard setback. Both are in regards to the garage and the parking space within. Pursuant to Capitola Municipal Code, the Planning Commission may grant a variance when it finds that, one, there is a special circumstances applicable to the property that deprive it of privileges enjoyed by other properties in the vicinity, and two, that a grant of a variance would not constitute a grant of special privilege inconsistent with the limitation on other properties in the vicinity. The variance requests will be analyzed on the following slides. The Capitola Municipal Code requires the proposed structure to have at least one on-site garage parking space that is 10 feet wide by 20 feet deep. The garage must also be at least 4 feet from the side, 4 feet 11 inches from the side property line. Due to the location of the existing structure, the applicant can only fit a 9 foot wide covered parking space with the construction of the new garage, which is required. Additionally, the garage comes within 4 feet of the property line, which is 11 inches less than what is required for these setbacks. In relation to variance finding A, the subject property is an irregularly shaped lot. The rear property line is angled, therefore one side of the property is 16 feet shorter than the other. In addition, the structure at 307 McCormick Avenue, as well as several surrounding properties, are misaligned with the property boundaries. Due to the property shape and historical orientation of development on this lot and surrounding lots, the strict application of the development standards for parking space dimensions would deprive the subject property of privileges enjoyed by other properties in the vicinity and under identical zone classification. In relation to variance finding B, staff reviewed characteristics and lot dimensions of 11 properties along the west side of McCormick Avenue between Park Avenue and Loma Avenue. 8 of the observed 11 properties have garages or carports, and 5 of those garages and carports appear to have non-conforming side yard setbacks. Therefore, a grant of a variance would not constitute a grant of a special privilege because the multiple properties in the vicinity have existing garages or carports that encroach into the required side setbacks and would not otherwise meet minimum parking dimensions if they had complied with all other development standards. The structure, as mentioned before, is non-conforming due to the south side of the structure on the single story. Staff reviewed the proposal that it does not exceed 80% of the fair market value of the structure, and staff found that the alterations constitute 55% of the present fair market value of the structure, so the alterations are permissible. With the approval of a variance for the garage setbacks and covered parking dimensions, the project otherwise complies with the parking requirements. We also wanted to note that the existing structure on the encroaching south side has eaves that actually extend over their property line. Because the proposal will include a reconstruction of the roof, the applicant has proposed removing eaves on that south side so that they do not cross property lines any longer. Municipal code allows for maximum driveway width of 40% of lot width, and currently the entire front yard is gravel and utilized for parking across the majority of the street frontage. The proposed project will bring the landscape area into compliance with the maximum driveway width and landscaping, and will replace the gravel area between the new driveway and the south property line with regular landscaping to not be used by additional parking. To this, condition number 6 requires the applicant to submit a landscape plan for approval by the community development director prior to issuance of a building permit. With that, staff recommends the Planning Commission approve the project based on the conditions and findings for approval.
Okay, thank you, Sean. Are there any questions for staff?
Yes, I do.
Commissioner Newman?
Thank you. I didn't understand the reason for two variances, one being a small side yard variance on the north side and the other being a variance for the smaller size for the parking space. Why, if we're going to approve a side yard variance, why don't we do it for a standard size parking space? What's the reasoning there?
So I'm looking to see if the applicant or owner are present, see if they'd like to explain that. I don't see them. Oh, I do see the owner. I don't know if he would like to discuss, though.
Well, if the staff doesn't have any thoughts on that, we can let him address it when we open the public hearing.
I can address that to some degree about why they proposed it this way. In short, they are trying to negotiate in between the differences in standards. They wanted to maintain some level of setback from the adjacent property. So to that effect, they wanted to maintain a 4-foot buffer between properties. But they also wanted to make sure the space inside the garage was functional. So they went in between both standards and applied for the variance that you've seen.
Okay, any other questions for staff? I have one, and I'm curious if, and I didn't see this in the ARC and site discussion, was the issue of privacy on the adjacent properties addressed because of the second story deck? And also I'm curious as to why the west side of the second story deck is parallel to the property line on Bay Avenue. Why isn't it squared off? Because if there is a privacy issue, even if we were to require 6-foot walls on each side of the deck to alleviate that problem, we couldn't do it because of the way the deck is angled. So I'm curious as to why that is.
To clarify that second question, are you asking why the rear deck is angled larger on one side than the other?
Yeah, because if there are privacy issues, they can't even be resolved with adding sidewalls to the deck on the north and south sides of the deck. It doesn't appear that ARC and site even address the privacy issues.
The deck there was angled, as you see, to comply with the second or the rear setbacks for the first and second story.
Okay. That makes sense. I thought that might be the case.
It did come up briefly in the planning or the ARC and site meeting as to the privacy impacts. Our local architect did weigh in, and he felt that this was a design that addressed that and built it into the setbacks. Relating to the neighboring property. On the north face, there's a window above the stairwell, and that's it. There are no other windows facing that property. And the deck is, as you see it, it is as far towards the middle as it can be, but I can let one of the owners speak if they want to discuss that further.
Okay, thank you, Sean. Okay, so this is a public hearing, and then it's time to open it up to the public. Is the owner ready to speak?
Yes, I see that they have raised their hand.
Okay, Mr. Rathjens, if you unmute your screen, you'll be able to speak.
Okay, here I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. What would you like me to comment on?
Well, this is your time to respond to any concerns the Planning Commission had or to add any additional information to support your application.
No, I don't have anything further.
Okay.
And if you have questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Okay. Is there any questions for the owner of the property?
I have a question, Commissioner Christensen. Has a question.
Go ahead.
I'm curious with the along the lines of what Commissioner Newman was addressing, the I was just curious why the 4-foot mark. It seems like if you were to just to push it to 3-foot passage, I mean, I can understand why you want to have a nice passage on that side for your side setback, because the other side seems to have none. But if you, I mean, even if you were to square off your garage and create a 3-foot passage, it would, you know, enable you to have a regular shaped parking space. I'm just curious why are you going for both variances?
Okay, so you can still hear me. I think we actually wanted to square off the garage. And I thought that's actually what was going to be shown here. Dennis was having trouble getting into the call of the architect, but I think we'd prefer actually to have a squared off garage. And ask for, yes.
The single variance of just the encroachment in the setback.
Right. I think with the square, the way it's shown, it doesn't encroach, or it keeps, well, I didn't know, I thought the setback was 4 feet, not 4 feet, 11 inches. So anyway, I'd go either way.
Just kidding. There's a personal reason that that was.
Like, no, no, we'd prefer to have it square.
Okay.
Any other questions for the property owner?
If so, someone had a comment, or somebody else, there was a comment prior to the meeting, or you had a comment from email.
That wasn't for you. That's the public comment for the meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Rations. We'll bring it back to the commission. And can you read that email, please, Matt?
I believe Katie has the email that she will read or have read.
Chair Ruth, we actually have one more person hoping to speak this evening.
And you're muted, Katie.
Well, that's not very helpful. This evening, we have one more member of the public who would like to speak, Lisa Salvino. And Sean, if you can allow her to speak via Zoom. And Ms. Salvino, you'll have to unmute yourself. There you go.
Yep, I think I am. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Right, thanks. My name's Lisa, and my husband Jim is with me. And we're the primary residence, 309 McCormick, so we are on the north side next to this proposed plan. And we purchased this house 22 years ago. We've raised our daughters here. We have concerns about not only the variance, but Nick, as you mentioned, privacy, so I was happy to hear you bring that up. So the key things here, if we talk about the variance, we are concerned and we oppose it because the setbacks are non-conforming, which is obviously why we're here. It's not going to support the parking demands of this neighborhood. I would point out that we are not a permitted street. We are a highly used street for parking by employees down in the village and also tourists. Now that the outdoor dining is in place, which is wonderful, that Esplanade parking is also no longer available, which has created higher demand. Secondly, we talked about privacy. This is a big concern to us. You know, I'm not an architect, but in looking at the plans, it appears to me that we will have a wall, you know, 9 feet away from us. To be quite honest, the stairway window is not of a huge concern to me. But we have a reverse floor plan. So our whole living area, our kitchen, our family room, and our dining room are all upstairs. This addition will put a wall 9 feet from our dining room window, our kitchen, and most importantly, our deck. So when they're out on their deck, they will be able to see onto our deck completely. I mean, I could toss the paper over to them in the morning, as well as into our living room and our dining room. Now, I am happy to invite all of you over to actually come upstairs and see what we're dealing with, because you'll see it's a very small space, and we've lived here for 22 years. We haven't done any large modifications. This is it, and so this is a huge encroachment to our privacy. Then I also wanted to talk about kind of on the issue of privacy. Tom has owned the house for 20 years. We do know him. He's never lived as a resident in that house outside of a couple months during the fires last fall. He's had tenants this whole time. They have repeatedly over the last 20 years voiced concerns to us about his commitment to the duties he has as a landlord. There have been two separate occasions that you can look up years ago where domestic violence was happening and the police had to come. This was two different sets of tenants where this occurred. The other thing that I want to point out is that we're talking about this garage and making sure they have enough room for this garage. There was a garage on this property. There was a carport that he walled up and created a non-permitted room in the back. So there was a garage there. I mean, the house as it sits today is sized well for the lot. It's not a big lot. When he walled in that garage, there was no front entrance for visitors to the person who was back there. We had on more than one occasion drifters coming on down our side yard in the evening thinking they were going to see this gentleman next door. You know, this was when our children were really young. So, you know, given the history, we have no doubt that this is going to be a rental, and we'll deal with the same things that we've dealt with. Parking, you know, I know there's going to be two spaces, three bedroom house. I think it's just realistic for us to assume there will be three cars. And I think in closing, I just want to say that I really, as someone, you know, we have lived here for 22 years in this house. We are active in the community. We love this area and we're committed to the neighborhood. And I would really urge you to put the needs of the owner-occupied residents of this street and even the community when you're considering this proposal, because I think it was sprung on us. Literally, we found out about this 8 days ago, and that's unfortunate. So thank you. Any questions for me, I'm happy to answer.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Salvino, or Mr. Salvino. Any questions for Mr. Salvino?
Yes. I didn't quite understand the history of a prior parking area that was walled in. Can you kind of explain to me where that is on the plans or was?
But you could show the plans, Sean. I could probably point it out. There was a carport there. It was a covered carport. It was of normal size. You could park there were several tenants in the time we've lived here that parked their car in that carport.
Yeah, but I'm trying to find out where it was.
Sean, could you put the plan on the screen, please?
So it's right where the proposed garage is there, is where that's where the carport was.
Okay.
It might have been a little bit, it may have been actually a little further in towards the driveway, actually.
Okay, and that, you say that was closed in to make a room out of it.
Yeah, they closed it in. I believe Skip addressed it in his letter, too, that he wrote.
Okay. So that's currently a living space that's going to be turned into a garage?
Well, okay, here's what I can say. There is a living space that was walled off. The carport was taken out. The carport was taken out at some point, and the structure, the room, was walled up.
Does the walling up of that room affect your, I guess, the existence?
Truthfully, it didn't. It has not at all. Because if you're on my deck today and you can't actually see down into their yard because there is, trees, which I think, you know, they were somewhere here, but there are trees there that do prohibit us from seeing down. I mean, if anything, they can look up at us, but this is going to put them face to face 9 feet from us, which is just... It's a serious privacy issue for us, especially as the expectation is that it will be renters. You know, they tend to go in and out, and unfortunate for those that are primary residents.
Okay, any more questions from the commission?
We do have one additional public comment.
Okay.
And it's written, Sean, can you no longer share your screen so that I can share mine?
One moment.
So unfortunately, my read aloud feature is not working, so I will be reading this out loud to you for the record. Dear Planning Commission, our family, including myself, have been residents of 310 McCormick across the street from the Ruthgens home for 46 years. We were surprised to receive notice 11 days ago by snail mail of the current plans for a major addition and variances to 307 McCormick and wondered why we hadn't heard this before. I will note that over the years, I have watched the original garage on the north side of the Ruthgens home converted to an unpermitted living space and ultimately walled in. It seems disingenuous that now another garage will be built in front of the original garage. This new garage will not fit without variances. Our family opposes these theoretically hardship variances as they move the new garage even closer to the next door neighbor's property at 309 McCormick and shift the hardship to them. In addition, a garage narrowed to less than 10 feet is unusable by larger cars and SUVs and furthers both the need for increased on-street parking by the residents and adds the possibility of a new garage will also become interior living space as many garages in Capitola have become. I note from the online plans that there is also a planned roof deck overlooking the Rathjens' backyard. In 1992, when we applied for an upstairs addition at 310 McCormick, including an 8x12 roof deck overlooking our rear yard, we were told by planners and the Planning Commission that due to privacy issues, our roof deck was denied, even though roof decks at that time were unmentioned in the building codes. We appealed, but the city stood firm. My question is, if rear roof decks impinge on next-door neighbor's privacy, can it now be approved? If not, we also oppose the rear yard deck additions to the Rathjens' plans, no matter how small. Without sidewalks, curbs, and a narrow street, parking on McCormick Ave is tight at best, often used by village visitors and employees. We politely suggest to planning and architects that in cases where new construction may have a major impact on neighbors, including privacy and parking, that an initial requirement be, have you spoken with the neighbors? We were not afforded this courtesy, which I imagine would often save headaches and expense for future projects. Best regards, Skip and Marley Allen. Merrily Allen.
Okay, thank you, Katie. Yep. Do we have any other looming public comments?
I'm going to check.
There's no way Dennis Norton can get in. I'd sure like to hear from the architect.
He's not present in the Zoom meeting.
Okay, well, we'll close the public portion then and bring it back to the commission. I would like to say it was interesting for Skip Allen's history on roof decks, second story decks, because the council used to take a very hard line on those and not allow them. And I think we've gotten lax on that and need probably to go back to how we used to handle them and not allow them for privacy reasons. So let's bring it back to the commission. Any commission wanting to make comments, suggestions?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I can chime in with just my general observations. I didn't think this was going to be a problem. When I looked at the house and I saw that it was a single story house and that there seemed to be a lot of variances in the neighborhood over the years, a lot of two story houses, flat roofed houses, different designs, crazy angles, this and that. Very narrow side yard, and I did notice that the adjacent houses had these high decks, and it occurred to me, well, this this applicant is just trying to make his house or take advantage of the same variances or what have you that, that everybody else in the neighborhood has. So I just thought, in general, without actually having stood on his roof and looked at the neighbor's yards, that that he wasn't asking for anything that was unusual for the neighborhood. Beyond that, I'm willing to listen to other arguments.
Okay. Commissioner Christensen, you had a comment?
I basically, that's Commissioner Wilk hit it on the head. I understand. Actually, I need to formulate my words a little bit better. If you could go to the next question, please, or the next comment.
Commissioner Newman, any comments?
Yes, I do. So to me, this raises a general issue of the extensive use of variances in Capitola, which over my period of time on the Planning Commission, I've seen it them become more and more liberal. The state law requires very strict adherence to the requirements for a variance. We have been basically just seeing a flurry of applications with variances, with the idea that, well, we've counted people on the street who have old houses who parking or side yard doesn't comply with the current guidelines, and therefore we should let this one build that way too. But I disagree with that, and I've heard other council members express disagreement with that too, because the idea of having design guidelines is to upgrade the community and the construction in the community. And if the philosophy is to say, well, there's a lot of old houses here that don't meet those guidelines, so we should allow this one to build to not meet the guidelines, there's really no point in having the guidelines. So I have strong reservations about the variance. And I heard some things tonight, too, that kind of disturbed me, too. As you know, I'm kind of a rules guy. And when someone illegally encloses a garage and then comes before the Planning Commission with another garage that needs a variance, that I have a little trouble with that too, as a basis for a variance. So that's not the main rationale for my concern over this application. It's just basically that we should not be overusing the variance process every time an application comes in, because there's a lot of old houses that don't meet current standards.
Question, Ed. This is Commissioner Wilk. So I understand what you're saying. It makes sense. What is your feeling on this roof deck idea? Commissioner Ruth was saying it seems to depend on which commissioners are sitting on the dais as to whether or not they're approved or not. What is your opinion on that?
Well, I agree with the Commissioner Ruth's history on this. Again, Capitola has evolved on it. And it's hard for the public because there's some things we clearly don't protect, like ocean views and so forth. But the council and the Planning Commission has been very protective of privacy when it comes to decks. And that has taken the form of, in some cases, not allowing people to get onto the decks by having a doorway, in other cases by not allowing the decks. So I think it is one of the jobs of the Planning Commission to look into that. And it's a balancing, because I mean, both property owners have some rights here, but we have to balance those rights.
So your argument would be, because of the neighbor has a high deck, that's a grandfathered in situation, but a new build, especially in this extensive a remodel, should meet the code, because for your reasons, we're trying to upgrade the neighborhoods and not continue them in less than optimum conditions.
I think that's a fair characterization.
Thank you.
Okay, Commissioner Christensen, are you ready?
I just wanted to clarify. So the letter that Katie just wrote, or that there's the old garage or the old carport is where bedroom three is currently located. Is that right? Is that what I like interpret that correctly?
Sean, could you put up the floor plan, please? Existing.
Floor plan. I do want to offer to the commission that with the new information about possibly an illegal enclosure, you could also, we could come back with additional information if so needed.
I think that would be a decent idea. that was just something I wanted to clarify. At first I thought that the garage was, the proposed location for the garage was where the carport was located, and I didn't, if it was behind it, then I kind of agree with Commissioner Newman.
So could I hear staff, this is Commissioner Wilk again, could I hear staff's explanation for recommending approval of this variance then one more time? Ideally, I'd like to agree with staff whenever possible.
Sean,
do you have that handy? Or?
So did you want us to look at the variance findings again?
Yeah, so you said, you know, the conditions have to be, an exceptional, and you kind of went through them. Could you just, maybe I wasn't paying close enough attention, but it seemed to me that that's worth going over again, why your rationale for why the variance is needed or acceptable.
I can share that on the screen from the staff report if you'd like, Sean. Would you like me to put that up?
Sure.
Oh, yeah, if you can stop, I'll put it up there.
I think reflecting back in the report, the discussion of how the lot is shaped was one reason for the variance. The rear lot is at an angle, and then also the home itself, when it was built, was not built in alignment with the lot lines. But typically, you're looking at the lot itself is. It has a unique shape to it.
And it's not isolated to this property in the neighborhood either. There are multiple ones that are very off in terms of orientation, including the property to the north that is very nonconforming as well.
That speaks to Ed's issue, which is that shouldn't be a reason for a variance, right? We're trying to improve the neighborhood, not just continue to allow nonconformances just because the other houses have nonconformances. We want to make the neighborhood better, get them all conforming, because eventually every house will probably have to be remodeled one day.
Also,
right.
I don't think this lot is that oddly shaped. If you look at the site plan, I mean, it's got square corners on both sides on McCormick Avenue, and there's just it's a trapezoid, but it's not really that weirdly shaped.
Not for a side yard setback variance.
Yeah. I mean, we have some weirdly shaped lots in Capitola, but this is not one of them.
Mm-hmm. And
okay. Have we got all the questions answered?
I would like to point out one more thing. Just when people were talking about the setback of that second story deck, that the second story and the second story deck not only comply with the development standards, but by a long shot, the setback is 6 feet 9 inches, and on one side it's 9 feet, and the other side is 15 feet. So we're not talking about a deck that did not comply with the standards. It actually is farther from the setback than it even needed to be. So
I have to add, this is Commissioner Christensen. I don't mean to interject, but I do think that the north elevation, I feel like they have paid attention to not putting, overly large windows in that side so they don't stare into from their living space to the neighbor's living space, even though it's close proximity. And I would agree that most of, I mean, Capitola has really small side yard setbacks. So I agree that we shouldn't further intensify those as, you know, a nice, the standard, but at the same time, like, I like to ask myself when somebody's suggesting doing something like this, you know, what else would they do kind of thing? Like, what else would we suggest they do, you know? So it's, this garage is providing parking. If there was a point that they walled in existing parking, that's an entirely different point. But as it's drawn, I feel like that's as it's drawn, if we were just to be given this context, it's a proper solution for covered parking. It's a, you know, regardless of whether or not it's in the setback or not, it's still providing more parking on their lot. I don't know. That's kind of what I'm thinking at this point.
Okay. I haven't made a comment yet. I would like to see a redesign that creates a deck that can afford privacy to the neighbors if there's a necessity for a second story deck. If not, I'd like to see it eliminated and perhaps even redesign the garage so it can be constructed without a variance. Maybe we should just continue this item. That would be my suggestion. I concur also with Mr. Newman.
And a split vote would result in a disapproval.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably the best this applicant's likely to get is a split vote.
I would move to continue if that's.
Well, continue to do and for them to do what? To get more
in
the garage?
I mean, it's kind of fair, wouldn't you say? Just to, I mean, Katie, or I'd like to ask staff what, how would you go about investigating something like that? Is that a thing that, that you could?
Yes, so we could take a look at what has been permitted on this site and see if there was previously a garage that was enclosed. Sounds like it was a, so we can do more history and look into the record. It'd be helpful in this motion if you'd like to continue to provide direction to the applicant. So if we were to find that there's an illegal, you know, addition on the site, just providing direction of, do you have any direction regarding the second story deck changes you'd like to see in an application that came back? Any direction towards making sure there's a compliant, we can bring back more information on any illegal conversions that took place. But if you do have specific direction on the deck, this would be the appropriate time. And I don't know that you'd be able to give direction on the parking until we bring back that the information for you on whether or not there was an illegal conversion.
Katie, what's that? I'm sorry, go ahead.
Katie, can we deny this without prejudice so the applicant can submit a redesign and not have to pay the fees again?
You know, I think it would be less expensive for the applicant if you were to continue and have them and review it at the next meeting with more information. At this point, they're vested into a design and staff time, so you could deny without prejudice or continue, and we'll do our research and work with the applicant before we bring it back.
Well, I want to be clear that I just don't believe that the shape or any of the characteristics of this lot satisfy the state requirements for a variance, so I don't want to mislead the applicant into putting a lot of money into designing, making design changes that still require a variance when I don't think they can meet the requirements for a variance.
So wait, I didn't realize this was going to be this difficult. So the variances that you're concerned are the side yard setback and the parking?
That's the two they're asking for, but to get any variance, they have to meet the two requirements, one of which is special circumstances by reason of the shape and et cetera of the lot and the property. And they're telling me because one line of the lot that has nothing to do with the variance area is slanted, that somehow creates satisfies that requirement, and I don't buy it.
So, but what they said is that they increased the setback to 4 feet, thinking that that was acceptable, but it's 4 feet 11, so then they need a variance for that. So if they were to come back with a 4 foot 11 clearance, that would eliminate that variant, that need for that variance, correct?
If they had a proper sized parking garage.
If they had the proper size parking garage.
Well, they're asking for variance as the size as well as side yard setback.
Yeah. So in order to be compliant, they would increase the side setback 11 inches. That would squeeze the garage, so they have to push the garage. They have to widen the garage in and eat into their living space. And
yeah. Well, if I could interject here, I don't think it's our job to redesign the project for them. I think that is their obligation if we continue it and suggest that we're not going to approve the variance.
I'm trying to give them, per Katie's instruction, some guidance as to where our concerns are. Right. And so that's where I was going with that. Our concerns are strictly the variances, which is the garage is too small and the side yard setback is too narrow. Right.
And so and the roof deck and the privacy encroachment on the neighbors.
But the roof deck is not a, they're not, that's not a variance.
No.
So we're mixing two concerns here. There's the variance, which would probably satisfy Ed. And then there's the view shed or privacy issue, which is a whole nother topic, which is your concern. I don't know if that's its concern.
And it's a concern of the neighbors.
Well, it is, but neighbors have a lot of concerns. I'm concerned about how this vote is going to go. So well, I would like to.
Someone attempt a motion.
Courtney moved continuance, right? I'll second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second then to continue this item to our next regularly scheduled meeting or to the next meeting when the applicant is ready. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Yes, Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
No.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Newman? Can you repeat that?
No.
Commissioner Westman is absent. Commissioner Wilk? Commissioner Wilk?
I'm not sure why Ed voted no. So can we reopen discussion?
No, we have a motion on the floor right now with the vote started. We have to finish it.
I vote no then.
Okay.
I'll vote no. I'll vote no. Okay, Commissioner Newman, I think the ball's in your court.
Okay, I'd like to move, this is not the entire application, I'd like to move to deny the variance requests.
Is there a second? Chair will second the motion. Okay. May I have the roll call, please, Edna?
Yes, Chair Ruth. Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Westman is absent. Commissioner Wilk?
No.
And Chair Ruth?
Aye. The motion carries and the application is denied.
Well, that was a motion to deny the variances.
Well, that's a motion to deny the application.
I guess it amounts to that.
yeah. Okay, so that brings us to the next item, which is the director's report. Katie, any Any more information for us tonight?
I do. I have some information for you. So first, I wanted to touch upon code enforcement that was brought up the last meeting. We are going to take this, I'm going to take a discussion on this to our city council, not next week, but that this will go on the 22nd of April. So I'll be bringing that discussion forward, and it will have to do with signs as well as outdoor displays and just a lot of the stuff we're seeing around town. Second, I have really exciting news for someone who's been working on a zoning code update since she arrived in Capitola. The Coastal Commission, we are on their agenda for April 12th, and we received a letter from them a few weeks back outlining their changes. The letter was short. They had four changes for the overall code. One has to do with, actually, three of the changes are regarding visitors serving, and the Monarch Cove Inn, they did not agree with the change to add R1 to that, or single family to that site. They also, in our mapping, they've asked that we've removed the R1 from that site, as well as the depot, the Inn at Depot Hill site, and then some of the footnotes that we had put in the visitor serving regarding Monarch Cove Inn, that the exchange of allowing them to have single family there in exchange for an easement to a permanent view shed or nightly rental, they'll be recommending to the Coastal Commission not to accept those staff changes. The other change has to do with the future Village Hotel, or the former theater site. And on that site, throughout the village, there's always been commercial allowed on the ground floor and then residential on the any stories above the first floor. And they have added a note to that site prohibiting residential, any type of residential on the former theater site. So I actually took this to City Council last week. We drafted a letter in response to their changes, asking them to accept the original document as proposed and as submitted. We outlined some of the history of the Monarch Cove Inn, outlined some of the history of the former theater site. And with that, the council directed us to submit this the letter to the Coastal Commission. So the meeting is on the 12th. The public hearings begin at 9 a.m. You're welcome to view it. And speaking with Rainey, who's our representative, she thinks we'll be on the agenda around 9:30 in the morning. So I'm looking forward to that discussion, and we've submitted the letter from the City Council. So hopefully they hear our plea. But it is exciting that that will be going in front of the Coastal Commission. And then after that, any modifications that they do ask for will have to go back to our City Council and in order for it to be certified and take effect in Capitola. So those are my, and the last change that they asked for was, were not substantive changes, just regarding the language of protecting the views from the cliff above, looking down at the over the theater site. So those are my updates, and I look forward to giving you another update on our LCP submittal at the next hearing.
Okay, thank you, Katie. Are there any communications from any of the commissioners? Nope, hearing none then. Looks like we're all done. We'll adjourn the meeting to our next regularly scheduled meeting in May. Thank you, Katie. Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.